All right.
He's in standby.
Standby because there were conversations going on heatedly into the discussion. Are we on standby?
Yeah.
We're ready to go. All right. So on the front page of the Standard, a picture there of Baba Yao, the governor of Kiambu County, his wife and daughter, who are set to face charges. At least the DPP has okayed prosecution, paving way for detectives to arrest Waititu and 8 top county officials, his wife and daughter. And if you turn to page 8, you will get a better picture of that, a picture of his wife. And detectives say they'll pounce. Now, I don't understand why they are saying they'll pounce.
Yeah, why not?
On Kiambu governor and 8 top county officials anytime as DPP okays their prosecution. With at the top, the Haji gives EACC nod to arrest Waititu Kin on graft charges. And we talk about corruption. We cannot miss to talk or cannot fail to talk about corruption in the counties. And we are told that there are some initiatives. And Sheila, I want to start with you.
Yeah.
When you look at it from a Transparency International perspective, you say some things have been happening. What has been happening? Yeah. What more needs to be done? What are your thoughts on this?
Corruption is the greatest threat of devolution. Even when you talk to many Kenyans from the polls we have done, the research we've conducted, many Kenyans will tell you that the biggest threat is corruption. And we see that every day. I mean, I don't know whether there's any day I open the newspaper and don't see a story of corruption in the counties. And also when you look at the Auditor General's reports, we also have the Office of the Controller of Budget reports. I think there's a recent report which shows that almost just 50% of the budget is again just used for development. So it also just asks you, what value are we getting from the county governments? But I think that there's a lot of potential in the county governments, but what stands between that and good service delivery to Kenyans is corruption. So we really have to look into this. Issues of fraudulent procurement, I think conflict of interest, there's need for greater oversight at the county level. And one of the initiatives that we have, and we it's something shared with APNAC, is how we can be able to devolve anti-corruption efforts to the county level. I know we currently have been speaking to APNAC and have had initiatives on how we can have county assemblies, representatives network against corruption, fashioned along the lines of APNAC, so that we have champions within the county assemblies who are also fighting corruption. And we also increase the capacity of the members of the county assembly to be able to oversight and legislate on issues around corruption. So that's something we're working on, because we need to have a structured engagement with members of the county assembly so that they have the capacity and they are able to promote as they perform their roles as MCAs. We also trying to also work with the county governments and also strengthen their systems. These are nascent entities. I mean, it's just been how many years of devolution? Just six? Is it six or six years? So they're still new, and the systems are still young. So we have to nurture the systems so that we can be able to build strong accountability systems that will prevent issues around conflict of interest, fraudulent procurement, and other aspects of corruption that we are seeing being manifested within the county.
So during the break, you're talking about something you're calling political red tape. You're saying that is the biggest threat to the fight against corruption.
My take on this is that since independence, the police have been doing investigations, the Office of DPP prosecutes, and where one is found guilty is convicted by the court. Now, we've set up another body called the EACC. This is too long. The police will investigate, EACC will take up the file, they will do a report to DPP. DPP will look at it, and sometimes they say, no, this was not well investigated, take it back to EACC for further investigation. Kenyans are tired. It's too such a long period. My take is the police can be able to do this one thing, investigate, charge the person, the DPP gives his consent to prosecute, and the court takes over. But the moment you take the matter to EACC, you know, until up to last year, the EACC had not been able to get a single conviction since they were set up. It's only about last year when the Chief Justice set up these special courts to speed up cases. It's only able to get one or two other convictions.
According to the statistics, so they say they've had 122.
That has been achieved, I think, in the last 2 years since they were set up. My take is, let us, she was saying, people are tired of it. Every day you open up a newspaper, anytime you look at the news on TV, there's so much corruption.
Yeah.
And we are not happy about it, because money is going to waste. The office of the Auditor General, it is understaffed. In the last parliament, I served in the budget committee. And whenever the Auditor General come to us, he'll tell us, I'm not able to fully investigate these matters because I have little staff in the counties. So what does that mean? That means backlog of cases, yeah. backlog of investigations, maybe even update reports from the Auditor General. But the bottom line, we need to rethink about the office of the EACC. Is it really necessary in our setup?
But there's also the issue of governors. They claim that sometimes they get this money too late. So it's a breakdown of the system from the national government to the counties, where they say that sometimes their audit queries raised by the Auditor General, but the money comes in too late.
You know, there's also a misconception.
Yeah.
When we began the issue of devolution in 2013, the governors wanted their money. If it's Embu Kiambu, if you had to get about 7 billion, they thought they would get the money in one tranche. But government does not have the money. Government has to raise revenue through collection of taxes, and then they release the money as and when it is available. Okay. Now, look at even the report that we got as late as last week. These county governments were not able to spend over 50% of their allocations.
Mm-hmm.
Many of them got 48%. And yet, out of that 48%, about 30% of it goes to waste. So even if they were to get 100%, at the end of the financial year, much of it is donated back to government. So I would say again, they're blowing hot and cold air together.
Blowing hot and cold air at the same time. I'll come to you, Honorable Shabir, mm-hmm. shortly, because mm-hmm. I know there's another direction you want to take us. Mm-hmm. Honorable Mwaura, your thoughts on this?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, thank you, Wahiga. I don't want to fully agree with my brother here about bashing the counties in terms of corruption, because corruption is a shared function, if you can say so.
Corruption is a shared function.
Both,
the new term.
So
that, function. That I have not heard before.
Yeah, and also on a light note, actually. Okay. And Sheila is here. You're asking what APNAC has done, but it is through APNAC that I met my wife. So,
yes,
so again, and I became a member. So now let's come addressing the issue.
How you're going to deal with the counties?
About the counties.
Yes.
If you look at the standard, at the top there is Goha's new exam rules for schools.
Yeah.
Trevor, allow me to just speak in some seconds about this. We were running a huge corruption enterprise called exams. This was resulting in people getting fake qualifications. They were paying 30,000 to get an A. It's in the public domain. And that is why you also see governors who really, on a normal day, Sheila, you can tell this person has not gone to university. Mm-hmm. But they had a fake degree and a master's degree. So a degree in a political corruption and a master's in commercial corruption. And then these people, like Governor Waititu, they end up managing the county. They have no.
Waititu on record has said many times that he has those qualifications.
No, I am talking about myself. I'm fully responsible on what I'm saying.
But you're on our show, so we also need to question.
That is your part of the bargain. Yeah. I have to say what I think.
And if you say something
the issue
that's uncomfortable,
is,
I will stop
you. Look, I mean, if you, it walks like a duck, it quacks like a duck, it's a duck.
Why don't you go to court then?
When people are going to court, when I'm talking about Kiambu County, and you have situations where, and we must not defend corruption here. The issue here is that there has been misappropriation. Why this is in the headline is because someone has failed to do their work as governor.
Okay.
And when you look at, for example, Kiambu County, we lost about 1 billion shillings in 2017-2018 because of non-accounted revenue, that also was revenue in the Kiambu County. Over 1 billion shillings has also been lost on Kasoba programs where there is no accountability of who was paid where and how. And of course, the kickbacks, about 341 million.
Where are you getting this data from? You know, those are strong
allegations. I am a senator. We have these documents.
These are the documents that have been given to the EACC.
Exactly.
Is that part of what
you're
investigating?
Yeah, so it's not my own fictitious.
It's not your own figures.
No, these are figures. But here I can, if you want the documents tomorrow, I'll come with them. You just assure me that it will be with you on the show. Now, what I want to say is this.
Yeah.
That we have actually seen a lot of changes about development. The Washington consensus seems to be the only model of how you govern a country. Parties must have political ideology. There must be some party discipline mechanism. That's what we have learned from China.
Mm.
But it is not the only way, the Washington consensus. It's not the only way to do as development. Because you see, today China is developed. In fact, what we have been able to see in China, those people are not walking. They are not even running. They are on a sprint. And very soon they are going to be the biggest economy in the world. Why? Because they have serious party discipline. So that if today, Wahiga, you are convicted, you are found to be culpable in terms of corruption, is a party that removes you. And every civil servant is a member of that political party. It's a one-party state with a participatory opposition parties, about eight of them. But for me, I think they are very serious lessons to learn. Now, you asked a question about the SGR. This is exactly why APNAC is there. Because our excursion to China was, why is it that they are able to fight corruption at home but export it abroad? Mm. And the problem of China is that they don't want to be the new colonialists. They want to be seen to be non-interfering, so that you are left to your own devices insofar as you are able to give them business. Now that is where the catch is, because we know very well that our leaders have an incentive to look at Kenyans as a market to auction for these business opportunities. You see? So in terms of disclosure, it is true. We would want actually to have the SGR agreement in place, because what we have read in the newspapers, if it is not propaganda from the West, from Americans who are fighting China, then certainly it's a raw deal, and it is not going to help Kenyans, because it is transferring resources from poor, impoverished Kenyans, you and I, who are going to be mortgaged of our lives to pay debts that are not beneficial to our country. So this is a conversation we are going to have, because we would want to establish an engagement platform, a bilateral engagement platform on fighting corruption. Mm-hmm. You know, because if we do not engage, it is going to be continuing, and we are going to be seeing people making supernormal profits. Okay. And at the same time, there are very good examples. For example, there is a Chinese company that has employed 99% of Kenyans. So those are the ones that we need also to amplify.
Yeah.
So that then we are able to say that when we started looking east under Kibaki government, we were able to bring development more to our people in an equitable manner, away from the Bretton Woods institutions. But if we are not able to do so, and it becomes a situation where there is no accountability, by the end of the day, we are going to see a situation where Kenyans suffer more. And maybe let me also say something here.
Okay. I'll bring in the chair.
Yes, yes. No, let me come in, Trevor. Because we are very passionate about what we say. The issue of EACC,
yeah.
Nobody steals to be caught. We must remember that. This idea of kama uko na evidence, peleka wapi. Apana, nobody steals to be caught. Every thief tries to erase the trace.
Yeah.
The good thing about it is that now there's money trail, you know, and that's why you have seen Kenoti and Haji going to the US, to Dubai, whatever.
Yeah.
I hope they have gotten very incriminating evidence, because there's no way money can disappear the way Uko was telling us, that there's nobody who authorized the payment of the dam's money.
Okay.
But also, that is to tell us that we must also look at our laws to ensure that we give enough time to EACC, even if a case is closed,
yeah.
If they got crucial evidence 2 or 3 years later, because that's how much it takes,
yeah.
Then that case can be revisited. Finally, is the issue about budgeting. We must deal with the issue of budgeting. First, because people budget to steal. You put money in the budget,
okay.
Because unajua utaenda kukula.
Okay.
And in that regard, the issue of inflation, of the cost of the projects,
yeah.
And the issue of procurement and cash flow. It
so
is true as you said. No, it's true as you said,
yeah.
That when you are very hungry, then you are given food all of a sudden, you are likely to constipate, because
yeah.
You eat with the greed. If you give people money 1 month or 3 weeks to the end of the financial year,
yeah.
They are likely to misappropriate so that money does not go away. So
okay.
These are some of the issues that we need to look at,
yeah.
So that we can help our country.
All right. Honorable Shakeel, one of the biggest, the best ways to fight corruption is to have whistleblowers. The whistleblower protection bill is still stuck.
Okay. This is whistleblower restart. We've been very much on this issue,
yeah.
Since for the last 10 years. There's nothing new. There's whistleblower, there's illicit funding, there is beneficial interest, there's grand corruption. There are these issues.
Why is it taking so long?
No, you see, you must understand that if a bill, like eviction and resettlement bill, information, I took up the information bill as a private member's bill.
Yeah.
Then next time it took over, Nyokobi, who was specialist in this, she took it over. These things are coming. They will take their time. But unfortunately, as we said, we are but members. And that's what I said to the multi, by the multi, the
multi-sectoral
approach. You can talk till you're blue in the face, but we are going to be your agents in Parliament.
Okay.
Yeah, you want a bill done, we are going to bring it in as private member's bill.
Okay.
Right? So even the whistleblowers, which was diluted very much, is coming back with our partners. We have worked it at, it's coming back under a private member's bill. And that's where my brother will be telling you much, much more on how that is going to happen.
Okay.
I would like to deal with the two other issues.
Briefly, please.
First, briefly, yes. Firstly, the local government and the county governments. I was the mayor of Kisumu. I will not tell you what we did, but you cannot destroy systems and operations that have been devolved over 100 years of colonial government. The Local Government Act was a very strong, of course it was bad. As bad as it was working. Even 80, 60% of it was working. What happened in devolution? I was sitting in the Constitution Review Committee in 2000. We did not intend to throw out the old system. That's why we put the transitional arrangement.
Yeah.
The transitional arrangement was designed to fail. So these governors and everybody came in with new systems which were never tested, and that is where you're there.
Okay.
And as my friend says, my brother says, much of what is unaccountable for money from Mama Boga Nanini is the one that is being used.
Mm-hmm.
When I was the mayor of Kisumu, councillors would stand in line for the market supervisor every day to give them money. That's the situation. Mm-hmm. And when we stopped that by saying, we're not going to take money from Mama Boga for 3 months, then they nearly wanted to lynch me.
They wanted to lynch you? Okay.
Yes. Okay. Now, please, you must allow me this. You're talking about the SGR. You're talking about China. You know, this thing started 8-9 months ago in Copenhagen, where I was giving a presentation, and I asked this simple question in a presentation, that China, you are so strict about your corruption, yet you export corruption to Africa.
Mm-hmm.
It became so serious that the Beijing government contacted the embassy to find out what we wanted. Then I went to present our documentation.
Yeah.
They then came up with us, we're going to have a bilateral conference between the National People's Councils and ourselves, which then refined down to some sort of a workshop. Now what we are saying is this, even on the SGR, what we had learned is that Chinese don't want to get too involved in what it does locally. But we raised these issues, we said, hold on a second, why is it that China criminalizes corruption within themselves, but in public officials, but there's no enforcement on China to foreign corrupt practices?
And that's the question.
These are the issues we raised. We issued the raise of Exim Bank.
Yeah.
What happens, where the money is taken from one to the other and then taken out and given to Hong Kong? You know, if Exim Bank is given a job, or rather the contractors are given a job, the Chinese state companies. Remember in China, they've built 30,000 kilometers of railways an hour. So they have refined this thing. The state companies need to be able to keep themselves occupied.
Okay.
So they come here.
Okay.
Please allow me this.
Just summarize, okay, because we're running out of time.
Yes, but this is the crux of the issue.
Yeah.
They come here and they go around talking to government officers. You need, we'll give you a stadium here. And then they say they lace it with corruption. So that stadium is meant to be $2 million. They put it $4 million. Then they say, we as Kenyan ask for, under the bilateral agreement, for this to be done. So that it takes it to the central China to decide. And they do it for $4 million. So these are the issues we're asking them. We said, look, how are we going to have a platform to take these things forward? And then we realized that there's a Central Commission for Discipline and Inspection under the Communist Party, which then comes in to the State Supervisory Committee, Supervisory Committee with all the CAP partners, 46 discipline inspection provision teams.
Okay.
Now,
please
let me
sentence. I'm
the last sentence is this.
Final word
the last is. Sentence is this.
Is this yes?
That even in these companies here,
yes,
there is a supervisor who is responsible to the party.
And it appears
we are going to start putting a platform,
okay,
that we are going to point out companies, yeah, that have gone and given money to our officials in Hong Kong.
Thank you so much. Last one from you.
Yeah,
one line each. Go ahead.
No, my comment on the SGR, I wish that one of our maybe MPs can take it up and demand that information.
We are getting it under this new platform.
Okay. I'd also just ask that in all our you know, in all our transactions that we apply the open contracting principle, all right, where all agreements are open. Yeah. And then just allow me to disagree with Honorable Njagagwa about the issue about ESCC. I think we must protect our independent institutions, and we must give it the space to work. Saying that we're going to disband it is not the solution. But I think because ESCC and DCI have been vilified in equal measures at different times, but we must give them the space to work, and also we must ensure that there's limited executive interference so that they can be able to perform their mandate and ensure that they have strong investigations. But let's give them the space, let's give them the resources as well to perform their mandate.
One line.
I'll say this. Somebody came up with the issue of a lifestyle audit. I wish that was followed. In 1972, there
was a president.
That should be followed. In 1972, Ndegwa, the Ndegwa Commission, gave civil servants the right to do business.
That's
but regulations were never put in place. Okay. So they've been trading left and right. You find you're in charge of a corporation, you're the one who's doing business with that corporation.
Okay.
In China, that doesn't happen.
It doesn't happen.
You do not
conflict
do business.
Of interest.
It's conflict of interest. Okay. So let us go back to this life so that we're able to tell.
Okay.
Surely, you were just employed the other day, 5 years, and now you're a multi-billionaire.
Okay.
Where did you get your money from? And then we'll get the couple.
We get it there.
Those are stealing our money.
One line, Honorable Mwaura.
Don't steal and then expect, you start taunting the government to catch you up. If you steal, you're stealing from your own people. And when you die, your children will quarrel over that. Is that what you want? You only sleep on one bed. And let's not forget, tomorrow we are launching a strategic plan. And please, we want you to come and join us. Help us, we members of parliament, the few we are, to make change in this country.
We'll see what the strategic plan is all about.
And of course, we'll have coverage of that.
Yeah. 6 months from now, mark these words.
Yeah.
We're going to make, that's going to be, this effort that we've made in China is going to reverberate all over Africa.
6 months.
See, because, you know, the question, that the platform that we're putting together, that we will be talking now directly to the State Commission of Discipline. They, we are setting up that platform.
We're going to hold you accountable to that. No, this is a very strong promise.
No, just look at it. Lest we say within 6 months, you're going to start, because Malawi is already on our back. Zimbabwe is there.
Okay.
South Africa is there. You're doing a great job. We've just raised that issue. Now we've told the Chinese there is a problem.
Okay.
And the,
fair enough.
Yes.
Thank you much.
Honorable Isaac Mwaura, nominated Senate and Secretary APNAC, thank you so much for coming in. Honorable Shakeel Shabir, Member of Parliament Kisumu East and Chairman APNAC, asante sana. Sheila Masinde, Head of Programs, Transparency International, thank you. And Muriuki Njagagwa, Honorable Member of Parliament from Beren North and also Vice Chair APNAC.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for coming in. We'll stand by and wait for that strategic plan.
That's
see
right.
What else is in there that will help
fight
corruption. We'll see.
You'll be here in studio at that time. But
let's see what you're saying.
That's a direct invitation. All right, let's see what's going on here. Engineer Lazaro, another one. Leaders should stop misleading the nation. Corruption is like a cancer amongst them. People are supposed to be leading the fight against corruption are the main culprits. And that's the truth.
All right, let's see another one here coming through. Francis Kigondu says MPs can strike a blow against corruption by passing harsh laws against those convicted. Make laws to make investigations easier. Force courts to fast track cases like they did for the elections. Pass laws to force all suspects to resign, etc. But they fear catching themselves.
So there seems to be a trend. Astronaut K, this is Matters Agriculture. Our agricultural economists aren't in charge of planning at the Agriculture Ministry and Treasury. The looters are. Simple.
All right.
Okay.
And see another one here. David Wanjiku says the only way to curb corruption in Kenya is to change the leadership, cut their pay by about 60%, scrap all allowances and privileges, and let leadership be voluntary, not electoral. Only genuine people would offer to lead. For so much.
People always ask, what is Wanjiku saying? David Wanjiku has helped us understand that. Okay.
He presents the
let's see what else
SMS
we have.
SMS is on 22422. I believe that's the SMS line that we are going to right now.
Okay. Good luck, Jonathan. Wow. Right. Not the former president, but this gentleman from Eldred. The Big Four agenda for the president sounds like what we promised the country at our independence in 1963 that we are going to eradicate. After 56 years, we make other promises without taking stock of 1963 promises. Food security is the country's security.
All right, let's see another one here. CJ Chemweno from UG County.
Wasingishu
County.
That's right.
Parliament and Committee of Agriculture should come up with laws to protect farmers by contracting farmers to produce enough maize, beans, rice, potatoes, groundnuts, millet, sorghum, and all others.
Okay. Right. I think we have one or two more. Wesley from Mombasa. Jubilee administration lack the moral authority to fight corruption. We don't need to be told that institutions require space to fight corruption. That is total insanity. Fighting corruption in Kenya requires ruthlessness.
All right, let's see another one here. Also, we're trying to sneak in as many of them as we can. Mercy from Kitengela says, if only our leaders are listening, corruption will be a thing of the past. So true politicians are the ones who started this game of corruption.
Wow. And one last one. Tom from Gara. I'm curious. Does the panel believe in public service administration? Graft and corruption exists because we don't have structures in government.
Okay. All right. And that is where we leave the discussion now. When we come back, we're working out. Right?
That's right. Or Willis's.
Yeah,
that's right. We'll be right back.